You are a very diverse and remarkable group of people, and it's interesting to see how Pathways to Education, which really started as a program to bring government, community, and business together to try and build capacity in your lives and those of your neighbors so you had better choices. It's interesting to see when those kinds of positive things happen, the kinds of relationships that you build with each other, the kinds of people who you may never have otherwise gotten to know, you get to know. You start to realize that you live here in Toronto and in Canada in the most racially, faith, diverse and complex society in the world. That there is no other place that you could grow up and without even leaving your apartment building or your block, meet people who probably speak 40 or 50 different languages in the building you live in, practice the faith of all of the world's major religions or none, and can probably have someone who can tell you in the first person the story of every tragedy and every virtuous thing that's happened from Tamil families who escaped Mali Valkal, Chileans who came here under the oppression and murder of the Pinochet government, Bosnians, Muslims and Christians who came through that conflict, Jews whose parents escaped the Holocaust, Palestinians who are struggling for a state who came here to escape poverty and ghettoization. Canada has become a place of refuge and sanctuary, and all of our families came here except for the Indigenous people who have suffered through residential schools and all kinds of persecutions from being displaced by famine, war, or out of hopeful opportunity. There is no other time in human history, ever, in which there has been one place and one time where so many people have gathered as a result of so much hope and running from fear and crisis. No other multicultural society has ever, on this scale, been attempted or succeeded. Probably the last time we had something like this was Muslim Spain, which was one of the last times that Christians, Jews, and Muslims lived under one government and celebrated their faith in what the Agda Khan calls a pluralistic society. My friend Adrienne Clarkson, when she was Governor General of Canada, went to Bosnia, and she was in Garajda, which was a site of great conflict, as you know, and very difficult issues and as former Yugoslavia broke up. And she made the comment to me is that when you looked at the buildings, you understood that that country was once a different kind of place. She said in Garajda, on every corner, there was a mosque, there was a church, and there was a synagogue. And when you looked at the age of the buildings, there was a time when people built their temples to their faith as neighbors and must have met at those intersections and celebrated. And they weren't afraid of each other. They shared their faith. They shared their world. The Aga Khan, in what I think is maybe one of the most important books ever written, called The Roots of Hope, talks about our virtue and our hope as Canadians. That Canada, in his mind, for as a Muslim, is one of the highest expressions of pluralism. And he says that if you actually, whether it's the Quran, whether it's Sikhism, whatever faith you particularly adhere to culturally or because you've discovered it through your own exploration. I'm adopted. My family came from Ireland. Pretty hard not to be Irish and Catholic. You know, people think that there's mysticism in all of this, but if you were born in County Kerry, Ireland in the 1950s, you'd be pretty hard to be an Urdu-speaking Pakistani Muslim. It would be hard. If you were born in Lahore, there's a fairly good chance you would not be an Irish Catholic and that you would probably be a Sunni Muslim. These are the kinds of things that are as much geographic and historical, and not to diminish faith, but sometimes we attach a great deal of things to choice, which are actually often contextual. But he talks about this idea that as we advance as a civilization, if we can elevate ourselves from the more definitions of what other people define us as, and we move from what he calls tribalism, where we live somewhat in fear and associate only with people ourselves, to what he calls pluralism, which is one of the greatest expressions of humanity, is that we're actually living in the middle of lives that are people that are different. That we don't actually tolerate difference, but we celebrate it. And it doesn't mean we have to agree. I don't imagine in Bosnia, before people started killing each other in a series of genocides, that there was a time when it was very cool to be a Jew, and it was very cool to be a Christian, and it was very cool to be a Muslim, and you probably shopped at the same markets, and probably babysat each other's kids, and lived together. And somehow, a sense of tribalism, where difference was fear, that believing something different was somehow threatening to your own belief. And we live in a world where that is somewhat always a threat. And it's a threat when you look at what's happening in Syria and Afghanistan, where you have so many polarizations through colonialism, through imperialism of some Western countries, through the absolutism and extremism of what is almost a theocracy trying to be established, where people actually diminish each other and have diminished their humanity because they cannot see the humanity, hope, and faith, and soulfulness of other people. You know, it's an interesting journey for me, and I want to tell you two stories, and I'm going to sit down, and my friend Tracy MacCharles is here, and she's a lovely, dear, she's one of the most positive and soulful people and hopeful people I know, so I'm very glad you invited her, she's a dear friend. But you know, I was the first out gay guy elected to be major, of a major city in the world. And that was pretty scary when I was growing up. I was a meathead jock, I played football, and I was president of my student council, I was super athletic. And when I told my father I was gay when I was about 17, he said to me, well, Glenn, you can't be gay, you play football. I guess if I'd been a hairstylist, it would have been okay. I'm not sure what that, but it feeds the stereotypes. You know, and in some minority communities, you grow up where your parents are the same as you, right? You know, if you're a young Muslim woman, pretty good chance, very good chance that you have a Muslim mom. And you go through that and you grow up in a culture. And often if you're experiencing discrimination on how you dress, on who you are practicing your faith, you're going home to a family that probably supports you because they're also probably facing that kind of marginalization and discrimination. And sometimes that's overt, and sometimes it's just simply failing to invite everybody to the party when you have one. And that benign neglect can also be more destructive because it's so systemic than the overt racism which you can confront when someone says something awful to you. But it was interesting because when you're a member of an invisible minority, when you're gay, you have to self-disclose to people. And when I was growing up, everyone thought I was straight. So I got treated like a straight white guy, which is a pretty privileged position in our society. And everyone wanted everything for me, and the world was my oyster. It was only when people found out I was gay and through the AIDS epidemic that I started losing jobs. That when I first ran for office, people tried to set my house on fire, literally. Where I got fired from a job for being gay. Where someone took my apartment away from me when I was 21. Where my boss phoned home to my landlord to say, kick Murray out of the, I literally lost an apartment. There was no human rights at that time. And when I ran for mayor of Winnipeg, I went to the Muslim community, which was quite small in Winnipeg at the time. It was about 16,000 people. And I'm telling you the story for a reason, because it's a hopeful story. It has a happy ending. And the elders in the Muslim community in Winnipeg came to me and they said, you know, Glenn, we can't support you. The Quran says you're not a good person because you're gay, and we don't have a place for you in our faith. And these were some very old world thinking, almost. I would say, I think they would tell you today, since we're all good friends now, that was a somewhat medieval perspective. And we went through that, and they did not support me, and they worked very, very hard for my opponent, who was a bit of a social conservative white guy of quite a right-wing political view. And then I won that election without the support of my Muslim brothers and sisters, and I was sad about that, but I won. I then, about a year later, 9/11 happened, which was, especially for Muslims in North America, a pretty watershed moment in our history. And the attacks on the Muslim community in Winnipeg were pretty violent, and people had sprayed excrement all over the mosque. Again, someone tried to actually burn the mosque down and desecrate it. And the community was feeling pretty frightened and alone. And I showed up with the police chief every Friday for prayers. And at first they wouldn't let me in. And then within about a month or two, we were praying together. And if you go to Winnipeg right now, I'm very proud of this, we found land, and one of the largest Islamic cultural center in Canada is Winnipeg, with one of the smallest Muslim communities. And we built a brand new mosque. And we started a series of community dialogues, which this white gay Irish kid working with a lot of first-generation Muslims did. When I ran for re-election, guess where my biggest support came from? 90% of the money I raised came from the Muslim community. I would say 50% of my volunteers when I ran for re-election were from the Muslim community. When CSIS started really persecuting people in the Muslim community, we put Abdo El Tassi up for the Order of Canada, and he got it. And ever since then, Rule, who worked with me, I have watched the discrimination in the Muslim community become one of its biggest advocates. And in very few parts of the world would that be true. Because as a gay man, I experience horrible systemic discrimination, not in the content of my character or my skill set, simply because of prejudice and stereotypes about what gay people were. And many of the Muslims I represent, especially young Muslims, face that same discrimination. Women who choose to wear a niqab, I want to pronounce that properly, right? Hijab, thank you. See, always I better to ask than assume, right? A hijab. That's a choice you make, and how you define yourself is your choice. And one of the things about North American feminism is we get to define ourselves and not be defined by other people. And part of those networks are really interesting right now, because out of Christian Uganda or Muslim Iran, I run an organization called Rainbow Railroad. And we help young gay and lesbian and transgender people, and also people sometimes of minority faiths, escape from those countries, interestingly through Turkey, through safe houses, to get to Canada so they can survive. You wouldn't find that kind of narrative in too many places. There are not too many places in the world where people who are so different based on their race, their faith, their gender, their sexual orientation, their age, can come together and work together and build those kinds of bridges. It really is unique. I mean, if you're gay in Uganda right now, or you're a friend of someone who's gay, you're pretty much arrested. If you're in the United States and you're Muslim with the wrong profile, you can be the victim of rendition and lose all your civil rights. So these are things that we as Canadians have to hold dear. We have to celebrate that kind of pluralism. We have to live in the middle of each other's lives. We have to care about each other passionately. We don't all have to agree. Pluralism isn't your right, my expectation that you would agree or endorse everything I said. You can think I'm wrong. You can think my face is wrong. You can think my sexual orientation is wrong. You can disagree with my politics. But the one thing that we all share, and it is the one thing that is more vulnerable and so few people in the world in any country have, is our right to stand beside each other, to be different, and to live our lives openly and respectfully. Not to live our lives for the people we fear and the things we're afraid of, or to hide in the shadows, but to live our lives for the people we love and the things we hope for, and to dance in the sunshine, no matter who we are, what we believe, or where we came from. And Pathways to Education hasn't just been that capacity building in your life. You've come together to create a celebration of diversity in a way that very few people have. And on behalf of Premier Wynne and my friends at Queen's Park, I want to thank you for that, because you inspire us every day with what you do. Thank you.